So I'm also Rel Chris Dev on Twitter. And I work for a small development company based in Trinidad called Chris Dev. And my talk today describes the challenges that I faced in building a stock market regulation, surveillance and monitoring application, and how we overcame those challenges using a combination of Django and Pandas. I don't work for the Securities and Exchange Commission of Trinidad and Tobago, so my views are my own. And right, so our talk is divided up into four sections. So the first thing we do is talk about some background to the project. Then we'll introduce our solution architecture. And then we'll look at our Python or Django reusable app called Django Pandas. And then we'll take your questions, of course. Okay, so in 2011, the Trinidad and Tobago stock market was forced to migrate to a new trading platform. This was because the company that made the trading platform had gone bankrupt some years ago and could no longer maintain the platform, or could no longer were given support on the platform. So the new platform was great for traders, but didn't provide a lot of the regulatory hooks that regulators needed for monitoring and surveilling the stock market. I had done some previous work with the Securities and Exchange Commission, so I was asked to present a proposal for a system that could bridge the gap. The requirements weren't really well structured, but the two things that they wanted was that the system should be web-based, because they wanted to share whatever system was developed with other regulators, such as the Central Bank, Ministry of Finance, and so on. And the data we must, or the system would use, would be complete and finalized data. I never actually found out what that meant, but hey. And they said if our proposal was accepted, we would then work with key users to develop a set of more detailed requirements to the project. Well, of course, that is could only lead to one thing. The first thing we encountered was a very slow procurement process. I mean, we expected that as a government kind of bureaucratic organization. But 6 months between tendering the proposal and discussing and accepting and sign off to the project, that's a little long. But the more surprising was the fact that there's a lot of mobility. One might think, well, people work in bureaucracies, they're there for life. But that's not really true. There's a lot of interdepartment mobility, people leave and so on, so that these so-called key users, to tell the truth, there's only one left who by the time we finish the project and we deliver the system to the key users who frame the requirements in the first place, they've all gone on, they've been promoted, they've left the organization and so forth. And what we found is that a lot of the people replacing them, they don't have the kind of statistical training or technical background for this kind of system. And you, in any case, you have to try to explain, promote, sell the system to people, like a new set of people, every 3 or 4 months, which is leads to a number of problems. You know, you have long lead times for decision making, and then the requirements that we had, they were not well understood by the final users, because the people who specifying the requirements, they're no longer there. And the people using, so why do we have feature X? Because that's a requirement. why is that a requirement? So you have to go explain the rationale, sell the project once again. So, and of course, people would say, well, oh, you should use agile methods, you know, to deal with such problems. But in government contracting, you find that there's an implicit waterfall model, you know, so that you have to, the requirements is a deliverable. And once the requirements are put in place, they need to stay there for until the end of the project, even though they're no longer relevant or nobody understands why they're there. So, despite these challenges, we were able to deliver a system to the end users. We started rolling it out in the third quarter of 2013. It's called MAS, Market Analysis, Analytics and Surveillance System. And it's a standard Django application with a couple of exceptions. So this is the basic architecture components here. The things that different is obviously why are you using pandas? And then you see that Red Hat Enterprise Linux 5.2 and Postgres 8.2. In subsequent slides we'll explain why. Here's the system diagrammatically. So the setup, maybe I went through the slides too quickly, but we have some really ancient Dell machines as servers, but that's a legacy of server consolidation exercise that was done in 2010, and again, in government-style organization, there's a five-year period, so whatever is done, that has to stay, and we can't upgrade till 2016. Obviously, to build a modern Django application, because Red Hat Enterprise Linux comes with Python 2.5, we had to upgrade Python, and we are in the process of migrating the system to Postgres 9.3. If you note in the diagram, we have two servers. Well, we originally had three, but one was taken away from us because an exchange server failed, so it took our server away, and we had to do with these two servers. So we have two GoniCon instances, and we use Nginx round robin load balancing. The PG pool is because we were using Postgres 8.3 or 8.1 when we started, is required for replication. So we replicate the database between these two servers so we get some kind of redundancy. When we finally migrate to Postgres 9.3, we might get rid of the PG pool and replace it with something like PG Bouncer. The system itself is very read-centric because we only have one place that we really upload data. It's not a real-time system because, again, the users or the clients wants to only look at final data. So in terms of data, we retrieve data from the trading systems, servers log. We actually have a request, FTP or SFTP system job that goes up and retrieves this log file, which is an XML monstrosity. And we parse it using and load the data. Thanks to LXML because you know it's really really a horribly formatted Windows file. And so aside from the trading data, we also have a bunch of scrapey spiders that we use to get data from various stock markets in the region because they have to use it for comparisons and that sort of thing. And okay, so what is Pandas used for in the system? So we obviously we do a lot of statistical and time series calculations, so that's the forte of Pandas. And then one of the things that we found that we needed to do, because it wasn't implicit in the requirements, is that we needed to link trades and orders and be able to rebuild the history of a trade from when the order was originally placed to when it was changed and so forth. So we use Pandas' approach of split, apply, combine to reconstruct trade order books and calculate duration and duration statistics. An interesting use of Pandas in the system is the ability to do pivot table analysis on the fly. So we actually generate pivot tables on the fly. Pandas has a lot of facility for data cleaning. And we actually have used Pandas in our Django views because it could be easily rendered. So a Pandas data frame could easily be rendered as JSON or CSV or HTML or Excel. And we have a project called Django Pandas, which provides a manager and some other functionality so that we could easily render Pandas data frames from query sets. So let's talk a little bit about denormalization and caching. So with a system that is heavily statistical, with a lot of statistical calculations, obviously we don't want to do that on the fly. So we have daily summary data, so tables or models for storing daily summary data, and these are populated when we actually load the raw data. And we're also going to extend this strategy to also cache at the database level, if you want, the more expensive statistical calculations. Strangely enough, we're not really making that extensive use of caching, except at the level of the dashboard. However, we intend to use Django Cache Machine to do some query set caching. The thing that is holding back both data denormalization and caching is the fact that the user requirement is that they must have total flexibility over date ranges and security, so there's no standard queries, so you can't, you know, so you're kind of limited as to what, you know, what you could cache, because they want to put in any data range so that they can get the statistics calculated. We're working with them to change their minds about that requirement. So these are some screenshots for the Mass web app. So this is the dashboard showing some of the statistics calculated. This is our activity filter, which allows the users to drill down from a trade, and they could click on it, any trade, and see all the order history behind the trade. And now, you'd expect this should be easy, because clearly, in any real system, if you have a trade, they would have a key linking trades to orders. But for some strange reason, in this trading system, there is no link between trades and orders. So you actually have to use Pandas' capability of getting a bunch of candidate groups where this trade could be linked to, and then find the actual trade. So that I don't know if you could see, there's a green thing there. So that's the one that is the trade up above. So I don't think that could have been done easily without Pandas. And it's only about 4 or 5 lines in Pandas, or using Pandas. So this is a pivot table. So in this case, we taken a trader and we looking at his trades over a particular period, and we pivoting or we breaking down by security and client, and we're looking at the number of trades, and you can drill down from this into the to find out more about the trades and orders that made up this any cell in the table. We use Foundation 5, and it works best in Chrome, and the users love that because they hate IE for some reason. right? Not only developers hate IE, but users do, even in corporate environments. So high charts is used for charting high charts and high stock. This is not open source. We use jQuery data tables for the interactive grid. The only criticism about that, about jQuery data, is not responsive, but it's improved a lot. Okay, so that's the traditional client, if you want to call it that. We also use the IPython notebook with this project. The idea came from one of our directors who wanted to give the ability of the analyst to perform ad hoc statistical calculations using the data that we had in the system. We did a number of experiments, and then we came up with the best way to do it was to basically install Anaconda Python on the users' Windows workstations, put the actual project source code, and we have a minimal settings module, and where the installed app only points to the models that you want to expose at the IPython notebook level. And we create a profile for each application that we want to use. And IPython has this startup directory. So you put a script there that sets the path to include your application and sets the Django settings module. So then you could import the Python objects in the context of a IPython notebook, the Django objects in the context of an IPython notebook. So then you can just start up a notebook using the command, and then to make it even easier, we create a batch file and stick it on the desktop so they could start, and they believe it's kind of easy, right? So what was the user's initial reaction? Ooh, you want to turn me into a programmer? No way, right? Okay, so yes. But a few weeks later, the regulator, the central bank, wanted historical data for mutual funds. And they wanted it in a certain way. They wanted for each issuer, they want all the funds for that issue, and you want one spreadsheet, one workbook, and a sheet for each issue. And that's like hundreds of, it's about 40-something unit issuers and hundreds of different funds. And they were going to do it manually. So one of the analysts says, and they wanted it tomorrow, yeah. So one of the analysts said, I heard you blabbing on about something that this thing could produce Excel spreadsheets. Can you do something about that? So I sat down with the analysts, and we came up with this, which basically did what they wanted. Right? So when they saw that, they became enthusiastic. Right? And I put together some wrapper functions, and I added some documentation to the notebook. So this is a section of this user's IPython notebook that they use all the time, and they've been able to modify it. I just added the wrapper functions, and I basically take some of the more complex stuff and I put it in the startup file. So, right. And now I'll talk a little bit about our Django Pandas module. And it's been useful in this project because we don't only use Django in the traditional way, but we try to use Django to the IPython notebook. So it has two basic modules, an I/O module and a data frame so this is a typical Django model. This is how you use the read data frame method, which is currently the only method in the I/O module. So you could create a data frame with all fields, specific fields. You can create an index, and you could use filters and excludes. The data frame manager is based on the pass-through manager by PM McLennan, and it's in Django Model Utils, which is a great package by Carl G. So what you do is you overwrite a default manager with the data frame manager, and this gives you access to three methods: two data frame, two time series, and two pivot table. The two data frame method does exactly what the read IO. The two time series method supports two kinds of storage models for time series, long and wide. So the wide is basically a bunch, each column in the represents a column in the time series. A time series is a data frame indexed by a date time object. In the long time series model, so in this structure, there's three different series and it's stored long. And when you use the two time series methods, it pulls them out and structures them as a data frame with a time series index. We also, as I said before, support. But the real thing about it is, yes, you could use the real is to subclass the data frame manager and build your own custom manager with the methods and business logic that you need. So when I started, my views used to look like this. I had a mix-in with all the business logic to create a trade data frame. So my view classes were huge. And then I realized I could just subclass my data frame manager, and then I could put all the logic there, so then I just have a single line of code that does, you know, what I had before. Right?
Thank you, Christopher.